must realize you are doomed.
Oh, I don't think so.
Hello to all you beautiful people and welcome back to the Galactic Armory. Today I am very excited to show you guys how I made my General Grievous bust from the ground up. I've been working on this project for a long time. It took a lot longer than I expected, but I think the results speak for themselves. So in this video, I'm going to show you guys the techniques I used so that you can make your own General Grievous bust. Now this bust was 3D printed, so if you have access to a 3D printer, check out the link in the description to the files used. Otherwise, I do sell raw prints of this bust in my shop online. That is also linked in the description. With that said, let's jump right into this build. Okay, let's take a look at all of the pieces that go into this bust. We're going to start with the bust stand. Notice the spherical registration keys. Those fit right into the holes we've cut on the bottom of the base. Now here we've got the head, the ears, and the throat, as well as little mouthpieces over here. Now take notice of the sphere on top of the throat. It's actually part of a ball and socket joint. You can see the socket is here underneath the head. They are going to fit together, and it's going to give our bust the ability to move its head around so that you can turn it to face one way or another, or straight on if you want. Over here we have got a big mess of wires. I am actually not going to be printing all of them. You definitely can if you want to. I think it's going to make assembly a lot easier if we use something else. So I am only going to be printing these 5 pieces. Now that we've identified all the parts, let's get them on the printer. Now this whole bust was printed with bronze PLA from Xyletech. If you guys need filament, I highly recommend them. I've been using them for years. Plus, you can use code GALACTICARMORY at checkout for 15% off. So if you're looking for some of the best priced filament out there, I would check there. The printing was pretty straightforward. I printed the head upside down and just added a bunch of supports to the top of the head. I also had to split the base in two since it was a bit too big for my print bed. So in the next step, we're going to need to put it together. So here you can see the two halves of the base I had to print out. You might have to cut it up into more pieces if your print bed is smaller. I also printed a 50% scale solid version of the bust, just kind of help me keep track of where all the pieces go. Now to glue this together, we're going to need a few things. One, we've got the flat wooden surface with some sandpaper glued to it. We're going to use that to sand the edges of the base so that they fit closer together. Now 3D printing is pretty accurate, but it's not perfectly accurate. So sometimes when you have pieces fitting together, there might be a little bit more of a gap than you would like. So this sanding is going to help reduce that gap as much as possible. Once we've sanded both edges, we're going to grab some cyanoacrylate super glue. This stuff is very fast acting and it should hold both pieces together very well. We're going to apply just a few drops on the edge, and then we're going to hold the two pieces together. It should only take about a minute or two before it's got a pretty good hold on both pieces. So just hold it in place, making sure to keep it as flush as possible. You can see it kind of split apart on me. I was holding it too tight or too loose, I don't remember. But you want to make sure both halves are aligned as perfectly as possible. Otherwise, it's going to make a lot more work for us down the line. Once it's held together pretty well, just add a few more drops of super glue around the edges, just to be sure that it doesn't break apart on us. Now, a ball and socket joint was kind of new to me. I haven't really seen it used in 3D printing very much, so I wanted to be sure to reinforce the pieces that are involved in it as much as possible. For that, we're going to be using a product called fiberglass resin. It's a two-part mixture. One is like a liquid base, and then there's a dropper filled with liquid hardener. You mix those two together and the resulting mixture will begin to harden after about 5 minutes or so. Now for this, you're going to want to wear a respirator and some gloves since this stuff is pretty nasty. You also want to do it in a well-ventilated area so you don't stink up the place. Now I just use the lid of the container with some aluminum foil in it to mix a good amount of resin, and then we're going to brush it on with a very cheap paintbrush. I say very cheap because you are not going to be able to use this paintbrush ever again once the resin is cured inside it. So I'm going to brush it on top and bottom of the throat, trying to get it up against the base of that sphere as much as I can without covering the top of the sphere. We don't want to modify the sphere shape too much because the files are meant to fit together perfectly. And if you brush resin on top of it, it's going to change the shape and it probably won't fit so well. So we're just going to reinforce the base as well as the underneath, just to make sure that the pieces don't snap or the plastic doesn't break as we're trying to attach this head onto it. In my experimenting with 3D printed ball and socket joints, they have to fit very, very closely together or else it won't work very well at all. So once we've given the throat a good covering of resin around, We're going to let that resin cure for at least, I don't know, probably 8 hours, but I like to let it sit overnight so the smell goes away. Now that we've strengthened the pieces of the throat, we are going to start working on smoothing out the 3D printer lines for the rest of the bust. So before we can start painting the bust, we're going to need to smooth out the 3D printer lines. Now, like I said earlier, 3D printing is a very accurate process, but it is not perfect. So you're going to have these very, very small layer lines. Now what we want to do is fill in those layer lines so that we have a nice smooth surface for painting. And for that, the first product we're going to use is called Bondo Glazing and Spot Putty. This comes in just a little tube. It's already pre-mixed. It's used mostly in auto body repair. So that's where you're going to find this stuff. It comes out like a cream, and after a few hours of reacting with the air, it's going to harden, and then we'll be able to sand it down smooth so we have a nice smooth surface for painting. You should wear a respirator for this as well. Wear some gloves because I'm just going to be rubbing it in with my finger, and you don't want this stuff to touch your skin. I'm also in a well-ventilated area so that the smell doesn't become overwhelming. That's kind of a recurring theme with this build and with a lot of finishing 3D prints. You need to find a good, well-ventilated area so all the smells of the chemicals don't bug you and don't sink into your walls. I used to do this stuff in a one-bedroom apartment. It did not go well, let me just say that. So here I'm just doing this outside in my garage with the garage door open. We're going to let the Bondo cure for about 6 hours until it's fully hardened, and then we'll be able to start sanding it smooth. So I'm really not a fan of sanding, so we're going to try and make this as painless as possible. I like to start out sanding with a mouse orbital sander with a 120 grit sandpaper pad attached to it. Now this little guy is going to speed up the sanding process pretty considerably. It can sand a lot of the Bondo really quickly. You do need to be careful not to sand one area too much because too much friction will heat up the surface and the plastic underneath could theoretically melt if you went nuts on a single spot. And we don't want to sand away all the Bondo. We do want some to be left over to fill in those lines. So I'm going to go over as much as I can with the mouse sander, and then we'll follow it up with the hand sanding just to get all the remaining areas that I couldn't reach. So for the hand sanding, I just rip off a little piece of 150 grit sandpaper, kind of a medium coarseness, to finish off the rest of the areas that I couldn't reach with the mouse sander. Now you might only see me working on a couple of pieces, but that's just because I didn't want to film everything. The process is more or less going to be the same for all the parts. Now the sanding and smoothing process is definitely the suckiest part of this whole build. It's no fun, nobody likes sanding, but if you guys can make it through this, you are well on your way to having a beautiful looking bust. If you're doing this for the first time, just know that this is definitely the hardest part of the whole process. From here on out, it only gets easier. I've had a lot of people tell me that they've gotten into 3D printing because of my videos, and that's just great to hear. It's pretty obvious how much I love 3D printing, and I'm glad that some of you guys can enjoy it as well. If you're looking for a good printer to print out helmets, I do link my recommended printer in the description. So if you're thinking about getting into 3D printing, helmets, armor, whatever, go check that out. It's crazy to think how this one technology has unlocked so many fun projects for people to do at home. It really feels satisfying to make something yourself that you can be very proud of. So I hope you guys are able to feel the same way that I do. Let's go ahead and get back to the build with the next step in the smoothing process. Now the next product we're going to use is called Rust-Oleum Filler and Sandable. Now Bondo does a great job at filling in a majority of the 3D printer lines, but it can't get everywhere. I can't reach my finger in everywhere to get all the details. What this stuff is, it's like a thick spray paint that is going to help fill in those 3D printer lines. Maybe not as well as Bondo, but since it's an aerosol, it can get into all the creases and hard to reach areas of the helmet. I'm going to do about 2 to 3 coats, waiting about 20 minutes in between coats, and then we're going to take a look at the head after this is all dried. Now, if we take a close look at the top of the head, we're still going to see some of those layer lines, and that's pretty normal. You can't get everything your first go around. So we're going to be adding more Bondo, more filler primer, and sanding until we are happy with the smoothness of the helmet. I'm going to save you guys a bunch of time and just skip to the end where the helmet is smooth and we're ready for paint. Now when sanding, you want to gradually move up in grits from the medium coarseness like of 150 that we started with to some of the finer stuff. I usually end up at around 300 or 400. Once you've got all the lines filled in and all the pieces are smooth to your liking, we can finally start painting. Okay, so most of the general is white, so we're going to start with an ultra matte white base coat. I'm going to apply it to the head as well as the base where all the wires will plug into. Do this in light coats. You really don't want any runs at this point, and just take it slow. Once you've got a good covering of white on the head and the base, we can start adding in the other colors. Now the first color I want to add to the helmet is silver. Now the silver is on the little mouth grills as well as the ear and the little mouth details that plug in on the sides. Now we're going to need to do some pretty fine tape work, so I've got the X-Acto knife. We're going to cut out the areas around the mouth grills and then cover up the rest of the area so we don't get any stray paint anywhere else. Going to do the same thing for the ears, and then we're going to grab our airbrush to start painting. Now you really don't have to do this with an airbrush. I just like the extra control that I get when applying the paint with an airbrush. You can definitely do this with a rattle can, but you should cover more of the helmet in tape if you're using a rattle can, because those can spray a lot wider and paint can get a lot farther than with an airbrush. Now you can use just about any silver airbrush paint. I wasn't too picky with this. I just used the mirror chrome that I had laying around. If you apply it improperly, it basically looks like silver. So I just went ahead and used that instead of waiting for paint to arrive. Just wait a bit for the paint to dry before removing the tape, and then we're going to start adding more colors. The next color I want to add is black. And instead of having to tape so much, I'm just going to use some paint brushes and some black acrylic paint. Now he's got the black details on both front sides, as well as basically the whole, I don't know, the center part of the base. I don't know what to call that, but I've got a big paintbrush to cover all that. I had to do it in a couple coats, just so that the black paint looked solid and you couldn't see all the brush strokes. But we're just going to cover it all in black. Now that we've got all the base colors down, we can focus on painting the eyes, which was probably my favorite part of this whole build. I'm going to do all this with paintbrushes. So with me, I've got a burnt sienna paint and some black acrylic paint for mixing. Now, if we take a look at the general's eyes up close, you can see they're pretty nasty looking. So I'm going to add some shades of black in there, and we're going to try and make it look as like bloody and gross looking as we can. But first I mix a little bit of black into the burnt sienna just to give it more of a blood coloring. And that's going to be our base of the eyes. I'm going to try and color around the pupil as best as I can, since we'll have to paint that later. This is also a pretty good time to introduce you guys to my new cat, Momo. I'm pretty sure he's a Star Wars fan because he was very interested in just about everything I was doing with this bust. Now that we're done adding the base colors to the eyes, we can start to mix in some of the other colors, make it look a little bit more realistic. But doesn't it just look so creepy the way it is with the eyes still white? It's like some weird General Herobrine crossover between Star Wars and Minecraft. Very creepy stuff. So I'm going to add a little bit more black to the burnt sienna to give it a different color, and we're just going to start lightly brushing it over the other color. I kind of did a little like tapping technique so that the paint appeared a little bit more blotchy. After this, I did the same thing but with just straight black to finish up the areas around the eyeballs. Next, I got started on the eyeballs themselves, and for that, we're going to just start with a base coat of yellow. I used a fine tip paintbrush for this since it is pretty detailed work. We don't want to mess up the area we just finished painting. And this is going to take a few coats, since the yellow doesn't cover up everything the first time around. Now for the really fun part, we get to add the pupils to our eyes. Now for this, I used the finest tip paintbrush I could find, since this is really high detailed work. We want to be as precise as possible. So I also sketched out the pupil that I wanted to paint beforehand with the pencil, just to make sure it was the right shape and they were both looking pretty straightforward. I didn't want to get a cross-eyed General Grievous. So that's going to help make sure that we stay on track. With the eyes nearly finished, I'm going to add the few extra pieces to the head so that we have a complete head to work with. Now first, I'm going to attach the ears. Now the ears have little poles and holes to keep them properly aligned, but we're going to add some E6000 in there to really hold them in place so they don't wobble around. I just applied a little drop inside the holes and then fitted the poles inside them. Then we're going to add the little silver mouth details. I don't know what to call these, but you guys get the idea. And we're going to want to let that glue cure for at least 24 hours. Okay, now that the glue is cured, we're going to start adding some of the black details and weathering around the head. So I've got some black acrylic paint and the fine-tipped paintbrush that we used before. Now it does have some like defined scratches in the model around the right eye there, but I'm also just going to add a little bit of black around the eyes themselves. You can definitely go overboard in this step, so I just erred on the side of caution and only just did a little bit. The head is nearly complete. We have one last thing to do before it's ready. The next thing we're gonna do is add a gloss over these eyes, and that is really gonna make them pop. For that, we're gonna be using an airbrush with some Alclad Aqua Gloss. But like before, you can do this with a rattle can. Just be sure and tape off more of the area, since we don't want to gloss the entire head. Now this gloss is going to make the eyes look wet and realistic. It's really going to make them pop, and this really makes the eyes look beautiful. We're going to apply a pretty heavy coat, since if we look back at the reference image, his eyes are pretty shiny. Let's take a break from the head and look at some of the other pieces. Now here with me, I've got the stand that the whole thing is going to sit on. And I wanted this stand to be a bit different from the rest of the bust, so I went with a stone textured finish rattle can. I wanted part of this to look like an actual bust, and actual busts are carved from stone. So I thought it made sense to make the stand as rock-like as I could. This was my first time using a product like this, and I think it turned out pretty well. It gave a good result. It's got a nice, rough, rock-like texture. Remember earlier when I said I didn't want to print the wires because I said we could do something different that would help make assembly easier? Well, this is what I had in mind. I got two different sizes of nylon rope, one larger and one kind of thin. What we're going to do is cut these into sections and use these as wires instead. The outer braiding on the outside actually looks like metal cords, and these are going to be a lot more pliable and should be a lot easier to fit into all the holes around the base. Now you can see I've got it partly assembled. Those pieces are not glued in yet. It's just kind of a way to see what I need to cut. I didn't care too much about what wires went where compared to the base model. I just found two holes on each side that I could fit a cord into and then cut that cord according to the length it needed to be. I got two different sizes of cords since there are different sizes of holes on the base, and it helps adding some variety. Here's a look at all the cords that I cut and the paint that we're going to use on them. I'm just going to use a metallic silver as well as a bronze, so there's a little bit of variety in the color, and then I'm just going to paint right over the rope. We're going to be using the five pieces of the throat that I printed, as well as the main throat piece itself, as kind of a base for the head, as well as the wires. Now it's kind of a tight fit on a lot of the pieces, so I've got some sanding pads nearby if I need to sand down the little connecting pegs, just so that the pieces fit together better. And here I'm kind of getting just a rough idea of how all the pieces fit together before I start gluing them in. Once I've got the angles and the fit correct on all of them, I add some E6000 into all of those holes and then fit this main contraption in there. Now it's time to start fitting in the wires. For this, I tried using some super glue, but I just found that a hot glue gun works better. I just started fitting the wires in the holes they were cut for, adding in some hot glue to keep them in place. With all our pieces in play now, it's time to start adding the final weathering details. Now for this, I'm going to be using an airbrush again with some black paint. Now you can't really do this one with a rattle can, but you can do a black wash instead that I've done in some of my other videos. I'm going to give a light dusting of black around the entire head and around the entire base, just to make it look a little bit more worn in general. But then I'm going to be adding more black paint inside the creases of the head to make it a bit more realistic, since that's where dirt naturally accumulates, is in the hard creases around objects. We're going to give the head an entire go around, and then the base as well. Now you can definitely overdo it at this step, so I always advise caution and to try and hold yourself back from adding too much weathering all over the place. With the head and base fully weathered, we can finally start putting all this together. Okay, the penultimate step to this whole thing, we're going to need to glue the base to the stand. For that, I'm going to use some E6000. I'm going to apply a good drop inside each of the spherical holes that we've cut out, as well as just kind of cover the stand with it. And then I use a cotton swab to kind of move the glue around a little bit. I'm going to let the glue sit for about 2 minutes, and then I'm going to join them together so that they have a maximum hold. Then I've got to wait 24 hours to the glue to cure. And it really killed me because I really just wanted to attach the head right then and there. This video is getting to be kind of one of my longer ones, but it's fitting since this project took a long time to make. I've even cut out a couple of the less important steps just to shave down the time. But I hope you guys can appreciate how much work went into this. Okay, it's been about 24 hours and we can see that the glue is cured. The base is solidly secured to the stand. And let me tell you, it needs to be because this thing can get pretty heavy. So we'll just grab the head and you can see we've still got the socket. We just need to snap it onto the ball on top of the throat and we will have our completed General Grievous bust. It takes a little bit of working since the fit is so tight, but since it's a tight fit, it should stay put wherever you adjust the head if you want it to look one way or another. Look at that. That is just awesome looking. I think I forgot to mention this at the beginning of the video, but this is a life-size bust. This is how big General Grievous actually is in the movies. So you really get an appreciation of the scale of how tall he is when this is just his head. I want to say thanks for watching, guys. A lot of man hours was put into this bust, but I hope it helps you guys if you want to make your own. I want to give a special shout out to my patrons on Patreon. Thank you very much for the support. It's been nothing short of breathtaking. If you guys really like my files, consider joining my Patreon. At the $10 tier, you get a monthly free helmet, which is like $20 to $30 retail. So you're already saving yourself a bundle if you join. Plus, you get to see these videos a bit earlier than other people, and you also get behind-the-scenes footage and shots, and generally just other fun stuff. Link is in the description if you're interested. Either way, thank you all for watching. I hope you learned something. I hope you're feeling confident enough to take on a project like this, despite how hard I've said it is. It is immensely rewarding. This is probably one of my favorite things I've ever built. If you want to see more stuff like this, consider subscribing, because I would love to see you again in the next episode.